Greetings, dear professors and dear friends. Today I will talk about mechanics of an inflation mechanics of an hyperelastic material tube. In this context, I will first touch on some fundamentals, and then I will talk about the analytical model, which is built upon a quantum mechanical framework, and then we will examine the finite element models, which is utilized for mesh sensitivity analysis and the model validations for plane strain and generalized plane strain cases. Mesh sensitivity analysis is just done for the generalized plane strain case. So a hyperelastic material is a material that behaves nonlinear under loading. And the nonlinearity is in the stress definitions, strain definitions, the deformations are everything are actually nonlinear here. In everyday life, our automobile tires, our shoes, in human body, our veins, and the components of human spine, which is intervertebral disc, is a hyperelastic material, and vein and IVD are also shaped as a tube geometry, and we cannot deal with them with classical elasticity formulations. But we use quantum mechanics and finite element method to analyze them. Intervertebral disc is a component of human spine, which is placed between two vertebrae comprised of annulus fibrosus, which is a composite hyperelastic tube, and nucleus pulposus, which is a jelly liquid, and cartilaginous end plates. Its duty is to dissipate spinal loads acting on the spine. The spinal compression acting on the IVD pressurizes the nucleus pulposus, and this pressure inflates the annulus fibrosus by compressing the inner annulus and stretching the outer annulus. So we make two assumptions at the beginning of the analysis. One assumption is that the thermodynamic tensions are equivalent to the derivative of the harmless free energy function with respect to deformation gradient at constant temperature. And the other one is that the change in strain energy density is equal to the thermodynamic work done by the thermodynamic tensions. These two assumptions takes us to the result that the stresses are actually a function of deformation gradient, which is denoted as F. And we know the C equals FF transpose. Strain energy density function, strain energy density is also a functional of deformation tensor. So we use capital letters for the reference configuration, and as you can see here, and the lowercase letters for the current configuration. While we're finding the deformation gradient, we transform the Cartesian unit vectors into cylindrical ones, and we transform also Cartesian coordinates into cylindrical coordinates, because we take, actually we write them in terms of Cartesian coordinates, because the gradient operator is in terms of Cartesian vectors. So the gradient deformation. We must implement incompressibility condition here, because the rubber-like materials, most of the hyperelastic materials are incompressible, especially the human tissues are incompressible. We have two ways to implement this condition, and both ways takes us to the solution that the current radius is a function of a nonlinear function of reference coordinate. Here we don't know lambda L and current inner radius here. We will solve them later, and we need to make another assumption here. This is the isotropic material must satisfy this condition here. Here Q is just a arbitrary orthogonal tensor, and if principal directions coincide with the material axis, the strain energy density functional reduces to only only related with the first three invariants of the deformation tensor. The first invariant, the trace of the C, and second invariant, the square difference between squares of the traces and the traces of the squares divided by two. And the third invariant is just simply determinant of C. So we found that the Cauchy stress, the true stress, current stress is a function of deformation gradient. If we expand this term with chain rule and further expanding this term with another chain rule, we get this expression. And so making these operations and taking derivatives, the resulting stress tensor is given here in terms of matrix notation instead of Einstein notation. These coefficients consist of more derivatives with respect to invariants. To take these derivatives, we must define a material property, which is a Neo-Huygen type of material here. That depends on the first invariant of the deformation tensor mu. Here is the initial shear modulus of the material, which is in the case 0.035. And we, because of the incompressibility condition, we replace the first term of the stress tensor with hydrostatic stress, hydrostatic pressure term, and making the operations, taking the derivatives, the third term of the stress tensor drops because A3 consists the derivatives with respect to two or second or third invariants of the C. They are just zero. So we don't know here P, the hydrostatic pressure. In order to solve it, we apply equation of motion in Eulerian description, in current description. If we solve this differential equation, we get P with an integration constant C. To find out C, we apply the boundary condition at the interval of the cylinder, which is the Cauchy stress in radial direction is equal to the applied inner pressure here. We get C. I said we have two situations, conditions, which are plane strain and generalized plane strain cases. For plane strain case, we know the lambda L is equal to 1, this boundary condition at other wall of the cylinder is enough to solve what A is, it can be seen that it is around 11.6 here. It's found that about that value. And for generalized plane strain case, we need another equation because we don't know lambda L either. For generalized plane strain case, the top of the cylinder is equilaterated. All the surface moves with on the same surface. Thus, the integration of the axial stress must be equal to zero. And we find A is around 11.8 and lambda L just a little lower than the 1. You can see the mesh generation process on the left. We apply nodal transformation after creating the model for a better handling with the model to apply boundary conditions, etc. This also reduces the analysis time because we apply transformation before, not during the analysis. And we use Hermann elements to preserve locking issues with the use of classical elements. Hermann elements consist of plus one nodes for node for hydrostatic pressure storation. You can see the boundary conditions and our starting mesh for the mesh sensitivity analysis here, which consists of 24 elements in tangential direction and circumferential direction, and one element in radial direction. Let me talk about the solution procedure. Because we analyze the cylinder as a large strain, because we are conducting a large strain analysis, we must turn on the follower load option because the pressure area will increase and this may cause the decrements in our distributed load, and we use updated Lagrange formulation instead of total Lagrange, which expresses the formulations in terms of current configuration. We applied the inner pressure in equal 15 time steps. The mesh sensitivity analysis resulted that the most sensitive region of the cylinder is the inner wall of the cylinder. We can see the results are converged at the intermediate radius. However, inner radius are still blurry. Thus, we biased the mesh at the end of the final mesh. We biased the mesh with respect to axis of the cylinder, and we can see the displacement values are much faster converged when we compared the radial stress. This is just because finite element calculates the displacement values before the stress values, and it derives the stress values from the displacements. Here we compare plane strain and generalized plane strain cases for the last mesh with the analytical results. Here we can see generalized plane strain case stored much more strain energy here, and we can make this deduction. The generalized the cylinder in the GPS case stored much more energy and experiences much more strains actually. Here also GPS experienced a larger radial displacements because plane strain case is much more constrained in the axial direction. The radial Cauchy stress is not changing with the condition of plane strain or generalized plane strain. However, circumferential stress is a little bit higher for the plane strain case, and we see a small deviation for plane strain case between finite element and analytical results. And the Cauchy stress in axial direction for plane strain case is much higher because it is constrained. The top surface of the plane of the cylinder is also constrained for plane strain case. However, GPS in the GPS case, the top surface is set free.
I think time is up, so maybe you can wrap up your results and conclusions.
Let me jump to the end. Because GPS, because plane strain case experienced a higher numerical volume change, because fully incompressible behavior cannot implement it in finite element. However, we see higher hydrostatic pressure in the analytic case of solution. Thank you very much.